So hello, I'm Shobhit Narang. So today we have Kubra Seth with us. Kubra, welcome to the balcony ticket.
Hi. It's so funny, right? We have the best seats in the house and it's called the balcony tickets. That's pretty awesome.
You know, I'm super excited for this interview for a lot of reasons. And I just can't wait to dive in and talk about things.
I have to say that the feeling is mutual. I am just as excited as you are. Maybe I'm a little more excited.
Okay, so Kubra, you are an actor, an anchor, a spoken word artist. But, you know, while going across the internet and doing my little bit of research, I also learned that you are a traveler. So let's just decode this traveling side of you.
I think I am the person that I've grown to be primarily because I have gotten out of this comfort zone. You know, I know many people have many experiences just by being in one place, but I just chose to have many experiences from different places,
right,
through different activities. And I think it's really funny. It didn't start as hashtag Wanderlust. I think it came to be a reality through hashtag, I don't know, like break out of the shackles of fear. Right. So I think the first time I ever did something crazy, which according to my mom is definitely crazy, was jumping off the Macau Tower, doing the bungee jump, which is like the world's highest bungee tower, bungee jump. And you have to be a little like cuckoo in your head to do that.
Right.
And I swear to God, that's a shameless plug. But I think that's something that kind of made me feel really close to myself. In that split second, I wasn't thinking about my tomorrow. I wasn't thinking about my past. I wasn't thinking about nothing except for that one moment of absolute pure adrenaline and pure exhilaration. It was that moment. And I think that kind of changed things for me. It was literally like, this is crazy to have this feeling where you are so particularly in tune with your present, you know? I think it took me a jolt like that to realize how sweet that taste is. Yeah. So I think after that, everything else that I did was just, you know, an extension of that moment or that extension of being in the moment. So there were different experiences that kind of collated themselves to be that moment. Okay.
That's such a wholesome thing to say. But now I'm intrigued, how are you navigating through this lockdown space?
By actually being in the moment, literally. So I remember when this lockdown started, everybody around me was pulsating. And these are people who I know are very calm in life. I'm the one who's considered to be not calm. I'm the one who's considered to be the one with the ants in the pants. And literally the lockdown is about to happen. And people are like, oh my God, I have to do this and that and learn this and learn that. And I'm just like, I need to sleep. Really, I haven't slept. I need to sleep. So I think I did that. And when I woke out of my slumber is when I said, okay, now I want to do different things. And I still didn't know what to do, but I kind of didn't put that pressure upon myself. So no, I did not graduate from Harvard during this lockdown. No, I did not make a banana bread. No, I did not bake a cake. I didn't do any of those things that everybody else was doing. What I actually ended up doing is taking care of my cat because my cat fell sick. So I became a full-blown parent during this lockdown. I ended up writing a book, which is almost near its completion. And oh my God, we're going to be a published author. So it's going to be like actor, author, and I think it's quite nice listening to it.
Yeah.
I think it was just about being where you are and knowing that whatever's happening outside could be frustrating to a very large extent.
Right.
But it's not really in your control. And if it's not, why am I ruining what I have? So I think that was pretty much the thought around it. And it was like, okay, let me just figure this out for what is in my control as opposed to trying to manage things that are not. And that helped.
You know, I wanted to ask you, what would an ideal day in life of Kubra Seth be like? And imagine this is like a pre-COVID world where we have access to everything and you can mobilize and you can go out. So what would an ideal day be like?
I would wake up, I would make my coffee, but that wouldn't be enough. So I would step to the nearest coffee shop, care to spend like half an hour in line and small talk and banter and say hi to 50 people and hug 70 people and buy my coffee and then chit chat along the way. I also used to sit like in the front of the car, you know, with my driver, because I wanted to have control over everything. So I want to control my music system. I want to control this. I want to control that. So I would do that. And then I would also ghost drive the car because I'm not convinced about hiring a driver. So I'm like left low, right low, do this, do that. So there's a lot of banter that's happening in my head and outside. Then I would do work, which is primarily meeting people. Which is not a real thing, which I've realized now. But then I do remember I've had some really, really productive days pre-COVID lockdown, pre-COVID and before the lockdown, wherein I actually shot for 3 different shifts in a day. So I woke up in the morning, I shot for an ad. In the afternoon, I got like a half an hour window to sleep. Then I shot for another show. Then I went, Then I went and shot for Tripling 2, which was like a morning shoot, like a night to morning shoot.
Right.
Then I slept at the set because we were shooting in Mud Island. I didn't come back home. On the set, I found a room and I slept there. And I asked my manager or something to get me a toothbrush. And then the following morning, I woke up and went for the shoot of Verdict. And I finished shooting that. And then I came back home and I slept for like 6 hours. I thought that was like the most amazing day of my life, like where I actually got things done. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I think pre-COVID, everything was about rush. Everything was jumbled and nothing had clarity. And you felt you had to be everywhere and do everything. I mean, come on, I have gone for the launch party of COVID. The launch party of Verdict, not COVID, sorry.
Right, obviously.
The launch party. Who goes to the launch party of COVID? I'm sorry. The launch party of Verdict. And then gone for a Vogue show. And then come back for the Verdict wrap-up. And then gone to a friend's house to celebrate over drinks. And I'm just like, wow, how can a person do all of this in one day? And clearly, pre-COVID, it was possible. Now ask me to do the same thing, I'll be like, no, talk to the hand. Like, no more. Now I don't have the pressure to be everywhere.
So, Kubra, you have got 21 acting credits to your name, but it would be just to say that it was Sacred Games. It's on IMDb. So, they say that they have got 21 acting credits to your name. And,
Wow, okay. So, I didn't know that. I should stalk myself on IMDb. Wow, okay. I didn't know that. Wow, thanks. I feel... That's really good, right? Considering I've been here for 10 years.
That's lovely. That's lovely. Huh. Definitely.
That's
so. But wow. I mean, it would be just to say that it was Sacred Games that became that turning point and made you this sensation. So how did that come along?
It was a round of auditions that made it happen. But there was an Ankur Tiwari who I had happened to meet at breakfast. I told you, right? I buy my coffee. Mm-hmm. See, I wasn't lying.
Right.
So I went to pick up my coffee from the bagel shop and I met Swanand Kirkire and Ankur Tiwari. And Swasa kind of prodded and said, oh my God, tu na acting kar tu, tu achhi hai, tu kaam kar, tu acting kar. And I'm like, haan, main tu kar, I did all of that. And then I think I must have turned my back and Swasa told Ankur, she's very good. And that evening I got a call from Ankur saying, you know, I was sitting in like Zoya's house with like Anurag and everyone. And I'm like, whoa, Ankur Tiwari is hanging with the Zoya Akhtar and Sayura Kashyap.
Right.
And he's my friend, wow. So he's like, yeah, there's going to be this call that you're going to get. I thought frontal nudity and stuff like that, but I know you're going to be okay. Mm-hmm. Just don't let that get to your head. Just go do it because I know you can.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, okay, and I swear to God, literally in that moment, it was important for me to crack that audition because really in that moment, somebody believed in me more than I did in myself.
Mm-hmm.
So it was not about proving anything to me. It was actually just proving it to Ankur that I was worth it. And now I just tease him all the time, calling him my godfather in the industry.
So how have things changed post Sacred Games?
I'm famous now.
Definitely. But I mean, has that led to better roles and more scripts?
Yeah, for sure. Work-wise, I think I broke out of the shackles of my own conception of being an anchor. I mean, honestly, I love that job so much. And I say it because I can't unlove it. I really do. Like, you can wake me up in the middle of the night and I'll be like, hey, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. That's me. I can do that like that, right? But acting gave me so many different dimensions of me. I didn't even recognize it. Right. There is really no process that I have cracked. I'm not an educated actor. I'm learning on sets. I'm learning from people. I'm learning from living beings around me. I'm learning through watching films now. I didn't go to film school to have like a viewpoint on what acting should be or how it's done. So I'm literally learning every day. For the longest time, I thought acting was... I thought that was acting. And then I realized it's not. You know, it's being present. It's being in the moment. It's about being honest with your lines. And I think the more real you are, the better actor you're being.
Definitely.
And that is something that I learned over a period of time. And my last year was just stupendous because I got to act so much. I played a lady who is fighting for justice for her brother in verdict. And it's like a period series. So it was like based in the 70s. I played a lady who is in jail as we speak, but hasn't been executed because we don't have women executioners in our political judicial system.
Right.
I played a woman who has sex with her students. Like, she's a counselor who has sex with her student who has zero morality. I played this beautiful best friend who knows her boundaries. And for me, it's fascinating that human beings have so many shades.
Right.
So I think if I am being able to justify a part that is given to me, it's purely because the way it's written.
Right. And I'm sure it testifies your versatility.
I'm glad that people can see it. That's, I think, something that's a revelation even to me every day. I'm very grateful for it.
So since you have been working in the OTT space, I would like to ask you, how do you perceive it? Do you think that OTT space is more open to outsiders?
I don't understand outsiders and insiders. Like, for example, I love metaphors, okay? When I moved into this apartment that I'm living in, right? It's not my apartment. But I was the first tenant in this apartment. But today when someone says, where do you live? I say, come over to my house. If I never thought I belonged here, I would always be the outsider even in my house. Na? I think an industry by itself stifles an artist. I think we need to create a culture, one.
Right.
But to fit into an industry or to fit into a culture, you should believe that you belong. I can't put other people under the bus because I think I'm inadequate. Or I don't think I have received enough. Of course, it's a struggle. I'm not saying it's not. Of course, it's survival. If I got one job today, I should be more grateful than having no jobs yesterday. But I think that's the way I look at it. But it's also because I didn't know I had 21 credits, for example, in IMDb. So I've done a lot of work. So maybe that's why I speak this way. And for me, it doesn't matter if it was a 5-minute role or a headliner or the lead or the parallel lead or a passing shot. It doesn't matter to me.
In fact, in your TED talk as well, you were talking about how you have always owned up to the roles. So even if it was a small part in Ready, you were very happy to do it and very proud to do it, despite everyone around you said that this might just be the end of your career.
Yeah, I mean, my career had not even started. How could it end? think of it this way, you know, if I go to light a campfire, I have to start with the small twigs. Some people are extremely lucky. Some people are really blessed. You put a log in there and it catches fire. It's great, right? But for anyone who wants to start from the scratch, has to start with the small twigs. Take pride in that, Maya, because it's your journey. If everybody's journey was the same, then hum khaak kahaniyan bol payenge na. Then what's the use? हमारी तो कोई कहानी होगी ही नहीं यार, कौन सुनेगा हमारी कहानी अगर हमारे पास कहने के लिए कुछ अलग है ही नहीं. सो आई थिंक दैट्स वेयर आई लुक एट इट डिफरेंटली. बट आई एम दिस ऑब्नॉक्शियस ऑप्टिमिस्ट एंड आई स्टिक टू दैट.
सो इनफैक्ट on something on similar lines, a couple of days ago you called out team Kangana Ranaut on Twitter, that handle, and so I just, tell us more about that and what's your current stand on the very aggressive nepotism debate in the industry.
I think nepotism, I've covered it in as many words in the previous question, but I think the reason to call out the handle was because no, it isn't personal. And I clarified that twice. But it's bizarre, right? The person who I had the conversation with is calm, but the army that you have fed and created is still wild. So these people are constantly telling me how terrible I am, how worthless I am, how ugly I am, how I'm a chatu, how I'm a chapluse, how I should die, how I will get raped, how my family will get killed. Who teaches them these things? It is not Kangana Ranaut who's teaching them these things. They have a safe haven because they feel they are sheltered under this ideology. And which is why I keep saying it's so important for you, if you are in a place of power, a place of position, then be responsible with that position. And that's where it came from. It came from no beef. I've worked with Kangana. She's a wonderful human being. I've sat across her in conversation, and she actually corrected my English once, you know. So come on, when you're starting off, and I think I Love NY, when I did the film with her, I think it must have been my second or my third film outing, you know.
Right.
It was with T-Series, and I'm sitting over there, and she's wonderful, and she's so kind. For me, I'm sitting with a celebrity. That's what I'm saying. Over a period of time, how much power, how much weightage, how much responsibility you've earned for yourself, because you've shown people the way. And if that way isn't right, even if it's not you writing, even if it's your team writing, you need to tell them what to write.
Right.
You need to guide them. I'm not going to let my manager, for example, talk unruly to a client. Nah? I'm not going to have anyone speak any way to people I love or people I don't even agree with. Why should anyone be vile? I don't understand.
But I mean, how do you deal with such trolls? Because this is not the first time that you got trolled or anybody got trolled. Because I mean, that's the most unfortunate thing, that social media, as much as we want it to be a safe space, we have failed somehow. So yeah, I mean, there were some trolls post Sacred Games as well. So how have you dealt with that space?
I think with all the criticisms that I received towards Sacred Games, like just today someone said, "Ha, you to look like a unicorn." I'm like, first of all, no. No, Cuckoo was not a eunuch. Cuckoo was transgender. Just don't screw things up. Just don't. Like, please, just stop, first of all. And it's got nothing to do with my face also. So please realize that. How do I deal with it? I meditate, man. I need to. Like, I would be haywire. I would be off center. I would be literally the praying mantis biting people's heads off if I wasn't centered. And I think it's really important for you to stay in a sense of equilibrium. Equilibrium. See, yeah, it's so hard for me to say that word. So yeah, that. And I think when you are in a place of watching your thoughts go by, I possibly think it's easier to watch even these comments go by. They don't leave impressions on you. I think gone are the days when people could bully me and say that you are this, you are that, you are that. And I really had to put an end to believing what people said about me. I had to start believing who I am and start building myself with my set of knowledge, my intellect, and the information that I was receiving. And I think if you're good and you're able to hone your skills, then that's good enough. Then it doesn't matter. These people are not important for any sort of validation or gratification that I need. They're not my audience. I don't want them to tell me how good or bad I am.
Do you think the OTT space is more egalitarian? Does it have more opportunities for women roles and women-centric films?
I think the writing is stupendous. Like, wow, Delhi Crime, Mirzapur, I don't know, what else? I mean, just recently, Bandish Bandits talking about, right, you know, classical music. Come on, we're such a rich country. And imagine we don't listen to such music. We don't have content on this music. You know, it's so amazing. Who are the other strong women that I've seen? The Shefali Shah. I was watching Thappad. I recently watched Pink again.
Right.
Or Gunjan Saxena. What a wonderful biopic.
Definitely.
I think there are so many stories that are worth being told. And the point is that somehow we didn't tell them because we said, "Arey yaar, female-centric films kaun dekhega?"
Right.
But or if I empower a woman, what will be the direction of my story? But I think it's so different. And there used to be a clear demarcation, right? Like, I mean, look at the times of the Smita Patil and the Shabana Az.
Definitely.
And I think after a point it became Konkanan Sen Sharma and Radhika Apte who were,
right,
you know, bearing this mantle. And now there is like another breed. So there have always been women in the business who have not succumbed to a particular look and feel. You know, they haven't changed their being to be appreciated or accepted. They've just been who they are. There's this wonderful Bhumi, there is the extraordinary Tapsee. There are so many wonderful women, you know, who are doing such incredible jobs as storytellers. I mean, San Kiank, look at that film, yeah?
Definitely.
You know, I mean, I think it's phenomenal. Phenomenal. You know, where it starts and where it ends. I think it's spectacular. So yes, OTT platform definitely gives them the opportunity to tell more stories. And we're not putting the pressure on the stupid box office numbers. Come on. I think that's like the... come on, yeah. Today we're fighting with the educational system saying marks sab kuch nahi hota hai. Magar films mein aaj bhi marks is equivalent to box office numbers. Kya farak padta hai yaar agar usne zyada marks nahi laya hai. Magar usko samajh to aaya subject.
Definitely.
You know, and I think that's what's important. Look at Omerta doing so well today on OTT, but it didn't do well when it came out on the screens. So I think everything has its time, has its place, has its audience. And as far as that is happening, we should just take a deep breath and saying, abhi bhi hai. Matlab, opportunity abhi bhi hai. You know, we can still make it us. We can still go through this.
You have a very special relationship with your mom and you have spoken about it. In fact, she was also your manager in the past. So tell us more about that.
Well, she is currently in the room. I told you earlier in the conversation that my cat was really sick, right? So at one point I realized I was the shittiest mother alive. And my maternal instincts are diminishing to zero. I actually had to call her and said, listen, please come over. I need your help. I desperately need your help. And I think that's what brought her here. But just what she's done by single-handedly raising two kids. I don't think parents are perfect at all. I'll add that by saying my mom is not perfect. But I think when she was dealt the sourest lemons, she learned to make something that somewhat resembles a lemonade. You know, and I think she did a very good job. And that's a quote from This Is Us. But I think she did a fine job. She raised Danish really well. She raised me really well. And I think that is something that she should take a lot of pride in because we certainly do. She turned us into incredible people, honestly.
That's so lovely. Okay. So talking about Danish, So Danish is actually our representation of Bangalore. That's how we know Bangalore. True, Danish.
True, right? Yeah.
So what's the relationship like? Because I remember in one of the interviews, you had said that when you are in Bangalore, you are his sister. And when he's in Bombay, he's your brother.
I wish my mom had two more kids, one in the east and one in the north. That would have been amazing. No, I think Danish is someone who has held his ground, who has been so good with his understanding of the format he wants to follow. His sense of comedy comes from a very sensible yet empathetic place. He knows when he's jumping the gun, he knows when he's crossing the line. I love how fast his mind works. And what I think stands out for me is the fact that he's unapologetic about what he does. At the same time, he knows how to apologize if he's done something wrong. That comes from primarily the upbringing. And yeah, I truly feel that I'm blessed to be known now nationally as his sister. Like, I was sitting in a office the other day and said, "Arre, iska chhod, iske bhai ka suna hai." That's so sweet. I remember him calling me once during the beginning of the lockdown and said, "Didi, you know, I just crossed your number of followers on Instagram." I said, "Ruk ja, beta. My next project will come, I cross your Instagram followers." And that's it. You know, as far as we can have that banter, and yet know that we're not, you know, out there to, you know, we're not rivals, you know, we just love to revel. And it's okay to have small talk with your family. And I'm glad I have the ability and I have the freedom to have that with him. And I know he celebrates me as much as I celebrate him. And that's what's really important.
Talking about family, I mean, I cannot not mention your cat. So tell us more about your cat.
His name is Shifu Seth. He's 7 years old. It's really funny because I think I have a habit of not remembering how old someone is. So I always thought he was 5. And then my mom said, "No, he's 7. And all of a sudden I started looking at him in a different light saying, "Oh my God, you're so old." And that's the time when he fell really sick. But I'm so glad that he's recovering. He's getting stronger. He came to us when he was the size of my palm. And he has blue eyes and he has these little brown streaks on his ear and has this constant frown. So he's always like this. And everybody looks at him going like, "Dude, why is your cat pissed off?" I'm like, "He just is." But I think when we're asleep, he actually unzips himself because I think he's a puppy inside. I think the cat is just a suit that he wears. He's really a puppy from inside. He's really friendly and he comes up to people and he tells them how much, you know, he wants them to pet him. And that's really bizarre because cats don't do that.
Cats don't, right.
So I take a lot of pride saying, "Hey, I have the friendliest cat in the city, dude." Yeah.
Right. So you have, I think it was in your commune spoken word piece where you had said that a human race is divided into two halves, one being the cat people and one being the dog people. So you fall in the cat people.
Cat people. Yeah, sorry to disappoint. This is a cat story.
I'm glad. Tell us more about your journey with commune, because you have done, I think, 5 videos with them so far, 5 or 6 spoken word pieces with them. And all of them were very vulnerable and very personal.
I think that's the beauty of commune. The fact that everything is so personal, everything is autobiographical to a very large extent. And the funny thing is that we all have stories, but we just don't have an outlet, or we don't know how to frame our story. And I think commune helped me do that. Commune said, "I see a story there. I want you to write it." And I would write it about, I don't know, 50 times. And then finally end on a draft. And even that last draft will go through some ups and downs. And that's how I know Ankur as well, because he helped me draft my first story. So I think that's where the love comes from. Your family to me, they've been teachers, they've been guides. And it's really amazing, right? When you can sit with a stranger across the table and just shell out your most vulnerable moments, and they're not judging you for those moments. And then you're just like, oof. I think it's a free counseling session that I have with Commune every time I tell a story. And Roshan Abbas has always been a friend. I'm glad I can call him a friend right now at this point in my life. But he was always like, you know, I was Ekalavya, he was Dronacharya. Mm. He was always revered from afar. And I know everybody who's done anything remote in the writing business, in the speaking business, has looked up to him as a mentor. So I think in that sense, I'm just blessed that I have such a close interaction with Roshan Abbas. I call him Roshba. Yeah. And then there is Tess Joseph, who's prolific at what she does. And there is this wonderful group of people who are nurtured by Commune, by these two people, who in turn spread the joy. And I think it's fantastic. And for me, what's amazing is every time Spoken Fest happens, so many people are just sitting and listening. I think we've forgotten the art of listening. It's wonderful. I'm not saying listen to the same story 100 times, but I'm saying even the ability to listen, absorb, and allow those stories to shift something inside you. I know my father's story came from a story that I heard on, that I had heard on Commune. And she was a first-time storyteller. And she spoke about her relationship with the ceiling fan and how that represented her relationship with her father. And I was blown away. I was like, that's amazing. And I think that's what happens when you allow stories to shift something inside you. And it can only happen when it's real.
You started your career at a very early age. If I'm not mistaken, it was, I think you were 15 when you became an MC.
Yeah.
So yeah, how did that happen?
I was really tiny and I was telling you about Ajit Uncle, right? So someone called Ajit Uncle and said, listen, we want you to host the Padma Shri Institute of Physiotherapy Awards. So we are going to felicitate the top physiotherapists of our country. I'm talking about the time when I didn't know the difference between felicitate and facilitate. And Ajit Uncle said, I'll send you someone who's just as good, good as me. I was 15 years old. They made me wear a sari. They asked me, how much did I get paid for it? I said, you see my work and decide. And I kept saying, facilitate. I'm pretty sure of that. And then at the end of the show, they gave me a big basket of fruits, a chocolate hamper, a garland, and a plaque that said, thank you from the physio, from the Padma Shri Institute of Physiotherapy. I think the best recognition I ever received. I was very kid. I was super chuffed.
What are your dream projects?
I don't know if I have dream projects because I think every project that I do is kind of fulfilling a dream that I didn't even see happening. So I'm very grateful for that. I'm waiting for 2021 because 2021 is going to be massive for me. I just know it. And I'm working on a project that probably would be considered a dream for many. And I'm really excited about it. So I think we'll finish that dream, then begin another dream.
But as one far dream at as, a time.
Huh, exactly. One step at a time. But I think in the list of fantastic filmmakers, like, you know, I used to live in the same building as Anurag and I couldn't muster up the courage to walk up to him and say, hi, I'm Kubra, I want to be an actor. I didn't believe I was one. Today, I think everybody else made me believe that I am. And today I can have conversations, rightfully so. But I think I'm just waiting now for moments where I would be able to work with Raju Hirani, with Shujit Sarkar. I love to work with Hansal Mehta. He's such a wonderful conversationalist. I love him.
Right.
One day, randomly at a cafe, I walked up to Anubhav Sinha and I said, oh my God, you look like my friend. So bizarre. That is me. I really like to work with him. Yeah, kill me for saying this, but why not? We'll do a Karan Johar film too.
So yeah.
I mean, there's some great storytellers. I mean, come on now. You grew up watching Kuch Kuch Hota Hai. You saw the rise of the Shah Rukh Khan through storytelling that happened from the Yash Raj studios and the Dharma productions. I think they all have left such a strong mark on our cinemas.
Definitely.
You know? So, yeah, I would love to work with everybody as long as I have the opportunities coming my way and as long as I have some really nicely written parts. I really, really loved, you know, out of the movies that Karan has made, and he's not my friend. I don't know why I just called him Karan and not Mr. Karan. But, you know, the movie that he made in the first edition of Bombay Talkies, you know, the 100 years of cinema.
Right.
One of my most favorite films of him.
It was a beautiful film, yeah, agree.
That's a beautiful film, you know. So you know that man is a great filmmaker. Why wouldn't I want to work with him if the opportunity arises?
Definitely.
I love Zoya. And I could not stop telling people when that 5-minute part of Gully Boy happened.
Right.
I said, I've done a passing shot in that film because that's how much I adore Zoya. And this project that I was recently working on, I remember there was a party that happened there and I texted Zoya to say thank you so much because you are the only one who showed me that there could be democratic after parties in our business.
Right.
Because there was everybody in the business. I didn't need to be called. I had a 5-minute part in this film, right?
Right.
But I was called. I was invited to be there because it was not just one or two people who made that film. It was everybody. Every sound recordist was there. Every production person was there. Every writer was there. Every singer was there. Every rapper was there. It was amazing. And I actually texted her and said, thank you so much for having an incredible, for giving me the first incredible experience of a democratic after party. And I think it's all these wonderful people that end up making great stories. So you should applaud them for what they're worth and what they do.
In closing, what do you think are those 5 adjectives that describe Kubra Seth?
Oh, well, explorer, childlike. Damn, I hate words like bold, wobbly. charismatic, confident, work in progress.
Wow. So thank you for having this conversation with us. We loved it.
Thank you. I loved it too.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel and never miss an update on Film Interactions.